Again, we are gathered here for this worship. Put yourself in the presence of God to receive from Him what He has so freely offered, His love through Jesus Christ our Savior. Come together in a spirit of unity with your brothers and sisters in the church so that they might also be encouraged by our prayer and worship. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty and merciful God, font of all goodness, who knows the very thoughts of our hearts, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have left undone in your sight. Wash us, we pray, from all our sins, and give us the grace and the strength to live in your presence as faithful children. Teach us to bring forth the fruits of repentance and renewal of the joy of your forgiveness and love through the blood and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Lord Jesus Christ and by his authority, forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now sing together with the video, Before the Throne of God Above.
Then still pause. No tongue can bear.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, ascended to your right hand in heaven, as witnessed by the chosen apostles and disciples, and which we still confess before you today. May our hearts and minds also ascend to your holy throne above, and through Jesus Christ there continue in your presence. We ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading comes from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day that he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift of my Father that he has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before them, before their eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up in the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking up into the sky? This same Jesus whom you have seen taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven." This is the word of the Lord. The psalm response today is from Psalm 68, the first 10 verses. "God shall arise, his enemies shall be scattered, and those who hate him shall flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so you shall drive them away. As wax melts before fire, so the wicked shall perish before God. But the righteous shall be glad. They shall exult before God. They shall be jubilant with joy. Sing to God. Sing praises to his name. Lift up a song to him who rides through the deserts. His name is the Lord. Exalt before him. Father of the fatherless, protector of widows, is God in his holy habitation. God settles the solitary in a home. He leads out the prisoners in prosperity. But the rebellious dwell in a parched land. O God, when you went out before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth quaked, the heavens poured down rain, before God, the one of Zion, before God, the God of Israel. Rain in abundance, O God, you shed abroad. You restore your inheritance as it languished. Your flock found a dwelling in it. And your goodness, O God, you provided for the needy. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen." Our epistle text is taken from 1 Peter, portions of the 4th chapter and 5th chapter. "Beloved, do not be surprised at fiery trials when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you're blessed, because the Holy Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is the time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome of those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls like a lion roaring in the wilderness, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brothers and sisters throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of grace, who has called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To Him be dominion forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Join now in singing, "Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place." Comes from chapter 17 of John. When Jesus had spoken these words, He lifted up to his eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you. For I have given to them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in the truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those whom you gave me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. This is the gospel of the Lord. We sing now, How Firm a Foundation.
How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, it is laid for your faith in His excellent word. What more can He say than to you He has said, to you look for refuge to Jesus.
Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The title of our message today is What Jesus Has Prayed for Us. There was a mother who had raised 9 children in the middle of Nowheresville. And as she raised these children, she was a good mother. They struggled. They weren't the poorest people in the community, but they weren't rich either. But she kept them washed, saying to these children, being poor doesn't mean you have to be dirty. And she kept them fed, saying, well, that's all you're going to get today, so you will finish everything in front of you. And she taught them how to pray. Pray on their knees every evening, saying to them, God loves your prayers and He hears them. So you should always pray. That Christian mother went on to be with Jesus, of course. That happened decades ago. But every one of her 9 children is a person of faith and constant prayer. Jesus taught His disciples to pray. In Luke chapter 11, we see Jesus taught prayer in two ways. He taught it by modeling a life of prayer, and he also taught it by instruction, instructing in prayer. In Luke chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, it says that one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples came to him and said, "Lord, teach us to pray the way John taught his disciples to pray." And Jesus then said to them, "When you pray, say." And we know what follows. It was the Lord's Prayer. "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name." And so he gave the Lord's Prayer as a model prayer. So he instructed them in prayer. Now we have used that model prayer to this day. So over 2,000 years we prayed this prayer that Jesus taught to his disciples. And it is a model. It's not our only prayer, hopefully, but it's a model of how we pray to God. But Jesus went on in his ministry to actually pray for the disciples and the apostles. And in praying for them, he was praying for the church. He was praying for the church that would believe through them. And so he was praying for you and me. And it's that prayer in John, the 17th chapter, that I want to focus on today, of the things that Jesus prays for us. It is often called, it says, after this, Jesus looked toward the heavens and prayed. After this, after the supper and after the teachings and the things that he did there in those chapters of John preceding 17, Jesus then looked up to heaven and prayed for his apostles, for his church. And that's where we want to be today. Our gospel is taken from this text. This prayer is called the high priestly prayer. The reason for that is because Jesus is the high priest of the new covenant. You will recall that in the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there is a time where they give in the gospel, Jesus' time at the Last Supper when he instituted the new covenant in his body and blood. And he was, if you will, he is the high priest of that covenant. And so I want to think about that as Jesus is praying. I want to think about the fact that it is the high priest who is praying. If you think about the life of the high priest as it was in the law, in the Torah, the priest was the intercessor for the people. The priest stood in the gap. The high priest stood in the gap, especially on the Day of Atonement. With the blood of the sacrifice, he stood before the Ark of the Covenant, pouring the blood of the sacrifice over the lid, so that the people would be redeemed of their sin, be forgiven of their sin by God's covenantal law, by what he was doing there. He interceded for them. Jesus is taking that position of the high priest for you and me. He has that position for you and me. Not by the blood of sheep and goats, as St. Peter says in his letter, but by the precious blood of the spotless Lamb of God. So I want to talk a little bit about that. Jesus is our high priest. I want to make a case for that. In Hebrews, it's very strong in the book of Hebrews. In Hebrews 3:1, it says, "Therefore, holy brothers and sisters, you who share in the heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and the high priest of your confession." Now, your confession there means your covenantal faith that you have with God, how you confess what God has done for you in Jesus. Jesus is your apostle and your high priest. It's interesting to know, both the apostle and the high priest are appointed. They're appointed by God. And so he's the apostle because he's the one God sent. Apostle means one who's sent. He's the one who is sent. He is also the high priest, which God appoints. So if you think of Jewish history, you think of the history of the law and the ceremonial laws and that of the Torah, the high priest was chosen by God. So there was a group of the priestly Levites from which came the high priest. And they were chosen by lot from God. God would choose them. They didn't come together in a conclave. and decide amongst themselves and argue amongst themselves who would be the best high priest. They merely let God choose him, and they accepted whoever God chose as being high priest. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in this heavenly calling, consider Jesus the apostle and the high priest of your confession. He went on in chapter 4, the author of Hebrews, to say this: since then we have such a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. So not only do we have this high priest, but we have a high priest that doesn't have to go behind that curtain in the temple and offer the sacrifices season after season, year after year. He went once and for all through the veil of his own flesh into heaven to bring the forgiveness of God through his blood for you and me. So when he stands in heaven as a man, he stands as the propitiation, the offering, the acceptable sacrifice for our sin. He is the high priest as well as the lamb of the sacrifice. And then in Hebrews 5:5, so also Christ did not exalt himself to be made high priest, but was appointed by God. It's interesting that at the time of Jesus, a lot of time, even before that, of course, but at the time of Jesus, the high priest was appointed, not by God, but by a kind of an agreement between the Sanhedrin and the Roman authorities. Rome had a hand. Rome, this pagan empire, had a hand in who would be high priest. They didn't follow the law in appointing the high priest, only ceremonially, but the priest really was designated already. And we know that at the trial of Jesus, that the high priest, even when he left office, had influence, still had influence. So it says in Hebrews chapter 5, Jesus was appointed. And then it later says this: in the days of his flesh, that means Jesus Christ, the incarnate word, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who is able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. That means his petition from the cross, and we know the seven words of Jesus from the cross, one of which was, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Another of the, this day you will be with me in paradise. We know the prayers that Jesus prayed at the cross. But we also know that Jesus prayed for his disciples. He modeled prayer for them, and he taught them how to pray. And in this chapter 17 of John, he prays for them. And that is the prayer we're going to look at. He says this in 5, 9, and 10. Hebrews 5, 9, and 10. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest. And in fact, the high priest forever. So there's no other high priest. There's only one priest, one intercessor between God and man, and that is the designated, appointed, crucified, and risen high priest, Jesus Christ. And that priest prayed a prayer known as the high priestly prayer, the 17th chapter of John. And that prayer is the one I want to look at. I'm going to look at it through the whole chapter. We read a portion of that chapter as our gospel read, but let's look at the whole chapter. If you have your Bibles, you can open them now to John 17 and look there. If you have a piece of notepad, I want you to note down the seven things that Jesus prays here for the church. He prays it for you, these things. When he looked up to heaven and he prayed, and this is what he said. First of all, he says this, Jesus in the high priestly prayer. First of all, that we would have eternal life in him. That we would have eternal life in him. That's a prayer of Jesus for every one of us, for you and me. Everyone who calls upon the name of Jesus, everyone who has believed that he went to the cross and rose again from the dead for us, everyone who believes that, he has prayed that people will come to know that. He has prayed that would be in you. It was so powerfully that you would be saved. So he has prayed that we would have eternal life. In verse 3 of 17, it reads, now this is eternal life, that they know you, and he's talking about God, God the Father, they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Jesus Christ whom you have sent. To know Jesus Christ, whom God has sent into the world because he loved the world and because he wanted the Son of Man to come into the world to save the world. He wants you to know that God and to know that he is the one that God has sent to pay the price of your sin and to give you eternal life. Number two, the second thing that Jesus prayed, that we can be sure he is still praying for us. Now, you may think that Jesus had his work to do. He modeled prayer while he was with us, and that he taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer, modeled prayer. Any prayer that we pray, we can use that as a model that we would pray to the Lord. As a matter of fact, you know, I've encouraged you to take the Lord's Prayer and put it in your own words. Expand it in a way that is meaningful for you. We've talked about that before. And so, he is still praying for us. It's not that he stopped praying for us when he went to heaven, or that he stopped the intercession. That now he did his work, and now the Father is going to take care of us because Jesus did his work. He is constantly praying. Can you imagine this? He's constantly praying for you. Jesus is constantly interceding for you in every situation of your life that you find yourself in. Every time of pain, every time of temptation, every time that you have sinned and seek forgiveness, every time that you in your life petition the Lord, you petition him in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Because Jesus is interceding for you at the throne of God. It says this, and Jesus prays this in verse 9. I pray for them, for those you have given me, for they are yours. We belong to God because of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ wants to preserve us before the Father. He's there ready, willing, and constantly prepared to do that for us. So he never stops praying for us. Number three, he prays for our protection because we're still in this world. So one of the things that Jesus is constantly praying for you and me is for our protection because we're still in this world. We're still in this world. A friend of mine and I, a pastor friend of mine and I, were down in Louisiana, and we had driven a ways from where our congregations were in order to attend a conference. And as we were driving back on the interstate to our place where we were were pastoring, there was a car in front of us. There was a car in front of us. And it was, I would say, maybe 1,000 yards from us, I would say. And it was a small car. Suddenly, as you know often happens, the car kind of went off the road. And when it went off the road, whoever was driving jerked it back. Well, as soon as they jerked it back, it began to sway and turn around and went down an embankment and crashed. And we didn't see it. It disappeared into some very thick underbrush. It just completely disappeared. Well, we both began to pray. You know, oh, Jesus, save that person. Save whoever's in that car. Help whoever is there, Lord. Protect them. Keep them. Don't let them be killed or injured. So we drove up. We got out of the car. And we looked, and you could not see the car. You could see the skid marks where it went down. You could see how the grass was messed up where it went down the embankment. But then it wasn't there. It wasn't there because it had completely gone into the underbrush, and the brush had just covered it. So we went down, uncovered the underbrush, popped the back hatch of the car, and a mother and three children came out totally unharmed. Totally unharmed. I want you to think about how Jesus is praying for you because you're still in the world. You're still in this world where things can happen. You're still in this world where we make mistakes. He's still in this world where we sin. He's still in this we're still in this world, and he's with us as we're tempted. It says in Hebrews that he was tempted in every way we were, but without sin. He understands our situation, and he prays here for us because we're still in the world. And it says this in verse 11 and verse 15. But they are still in the world. He's speaking to the Father. And I am coming to you, O Holy Father. Protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, the name of Yeshua, the Lord saves. Pray that he prays that by that name we continue to be saved. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. Now, it's interesting about that word, the evil one. That's exactly what we pray at the end of the Lord's Prayer. Lead us not into a time of testing, because we live in a world where we have this time of testing. So, lead us not into a time of testing, that is, into temptation. But deliver us, we say deliver us from evil, it really is deliver us from the evil one. And here he prays this for them. Jesus is still praying for you what he taught us to pray at the end of the Lord's Prayer. That is constantly on the lips of Jesus, if you will, as he petitions before the Father for you who are still in the world. This world is not friendly towards those of the faith. In fact, it can be very unfriendly in some parts of the world. And so we know that we have this one who is constantly praying before the Father because we're still here. Number four, he prays that we have full joy in him. You know, the Christian life is supposed to be a life of joy. It's supposed to be a life that God has given us in order that our joy might be full. Jesus says, I have come that you may have joy and joy to the full, that you may have life and life to the full, that your joy may be complete. That's why he has come into the world. So he is praying that we have that full joy here in John 17:14, that they may have the full measure of joy within them. Now, the full measure of joy is the very joy Christ has with the Father in fulfilling his vocation, his call to die and rise again, ascend to his right hand to be our intercessor. The second person of the Trinity, God's divine Son, is filled with the joy of God. He wants you to have that joy in your life. And I know there are times now where that's very difficult. It's times in our community, in our society, where it's difficult to have this kind of joy. Sometimes we wonder what is going on. And yet Jesus is constantly praying that you might experience that joy. And trust me, if you look at your life, many of us have much to be joyful about in his presence. And remember that Jesus is constantly praying that we be filled with this holy joy that comes from the Father and the Spirit. Number five, he prays that we be made holy by the truth. That we be made holy by the truth. Now, the word holy is sometimes translated as sanctified. Sanctified is just a translation or from the Latin sanctus, which means holy. So it just merely is a translation right out of the Latin to the English, which is sanctified, that we be made holy. To be sanctified is to be made holy. And so he prays that we be made holy. But that holiness does not come from our effort. That holiness doesn't come from the fact that I pray a lot, or that I read so many pages of scripture every day, or that I make sure that I'm in worship service every Sunday, and then I start, you know, counting off all of these things that I do to make me holy. Okay? And you've heard the expression, he is so heavenly holy that he is no earthly good. And sometimes we can live no earthly good, but we think we're making ourselves holy before God. This was a big problem for Jesus in his day. We had everybody doing all kinds of things to supposedly make them holy, wash their hands all day long. And trust me, we're doing that now. I understand that. That makes us healthy, but it doesn't make us holy. And about how they kept certain traditions of the Pharisees and the rabbis. He thought all that made them holy. Made them holy. No, only the truth will make you holy. Just as the truth sets you free from your sin, if the Son sets you're free indeed. So, if you're made holy by God, you're holy indeed. It is God who sanctifies, it's God who's holy. And Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to us. He promised it to us, to be in us, that we could be a holy people. That's a truth. I'm the way, the truth, and life, he says in the 14th chapter. I'm that way in truth and life. And he says that truth about what God has done in him, that is what makes you holy. And as a holy person of God, then, we are the church. We are his called out in the world. We're called out of the world while we have to be in the world. We're called to be a different kind of people in the world. We're seen in many communities and societies around the world as being peculiar. And yet that is exactly what we're called, a peculiar people. We're His people, His chosen people, set apart for Him. Set apart is the Hebrew word for holy. So the word for holy means something that's been set apart, and set apart specifically for God's use. And that's what you are. And so he prays that in verse 17. He's praying to the Father. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. One of the hardest things I think to convince people of is that the Bible, the Word of God, is not myth and legend like every other religious book. In fact, if they actually read it and compared it with other religious books, they would find that it's a history book, number one. And number two, they would find out that it is very different in God's relationship to man than anything else that's out there that is religious literature or is simply humanist philosophy. Jesus said, "Your word, Father, is truth." Now, we can take that word, logos, there in a couple of ways. One, we can say the word that is spoken through the prophets, the word that was spoken through Moses, the word that is written on the scrolls, the word of God that we have from the apostles and writers of the New Testament. We think of the word that way. Word can also mean Jesus Christ, as it says in the first chapter of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and He was in the beginning with God. So we see that the Word is also Jesus. So when he says here, sanctify them in the truth, your Word is truth, goes back to what Jesus said in the 14th chapter, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He goes on in verse 18. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I have sanctified myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Now, why would he say truly sanctified? Because there was a kind of external sanctification going on amongst the Pharisees and the Sadducees of that day and the teachers of the law and the rabbis. There was a kind of external righteousness that they actually showed off to one another, that they were these righteous people. That was happening there. And he is saying to his apostles there at the Last Supper before he goes to the garden, he says to them, for he was sanctified and he wants them to be truly sanctified. Sanctified by his work on the cross, by his blood, the blood of the new covenant in him who is the true and forever high priest. Number six. And he prays not just for us. So Jesus' prayer here is for us, for these things that I've mentioned, but he also prays for others. He prays for everyone who will believe because of our unified testimony about him. People are going to still continue to believe the truth that sanctifies, the truth that saves. They're going to still continue to believe that as we give testimony with our life by example and with our life by instruction. We give example to everyone who would listen of how they too can have the truth of Jesus Christ and be saved. He prays for those people also. He prays for those who are going to come to faith in Jesus Christ. Now, at the time of Jesus Christ, obviously thousands, then tens of thousands, then hundreds of thousands, then millions and hundreds of millions and billions came to know Jesus. They are the ones he's praying for here too. Through all the ages, all the two millennia we have heard the word of God and have preached it from the time of the apostles till today, those people, there are people coming to faith in Jesus Christ. I just read a story of a couple in Southeast Asia. And this couple in Southeast Asia, a man and his wife and one child, they have one child, they came to faith in Jesus Christ. They came to faith. They literally have lived in families of centuries of Buddhism. Centuries of Buddhism. and centuries of ancestor worship. And now they have trusted in Jesus Christ. They have trusted in Jesus Christ. And they paid a price for it. They were kicked out of their families for doing it. But they now believe in Jesus. They are those whom he prayed for right here at this time before he went to the cross. When he was praying, that man and his wife and their child was on Jesus' heart. He was the one who would believe because of their unified testimony about him. This is what he says in verse 20. My prayer is also for those who will believe in me through their message. And in verse 21, that all of them may be one, Father. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you sent me. The fact that we remain unified in Christ, though there may be several denominations, there may be, well, denomination just simply means the way we call ourselves or the particular tradition we may follow in the Christian church, the one Christian church. We're unified in this message. You're saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, by his resurrection from the dead, and that Jesus Christ is at the right hand of the Father interceding for you, and that there is a place he has prepared for you. Jesus Christ wants to have a relationship with you, because he has been tasked as the apostle from God, the apostle from God, and as the high priest to bring you into a saving relationship with him that you may belong forever in the presence of God Almighty. God wants that for you. And that's our message. It's a single message. It's what they call the original gospel. That Jesus Christ died, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, sent from God to die on the cross for our sins and rise again from the dead that we might have life eternally with God. That's the simple gospel. And it is literally communicated all over the world. I'm somebody who's traveled to a lot of different places in the world. And I can tell you, whenever I hear anyone preaching the gospel, they're preaching the gospel. It's a very simple gospel, what Jesus has done for them. And you know, one of the greatest evangelistic tools in the world has been the Jesus film. And in the Jesus film, it's simply the story of Jesus told to people in their own language. In their own language. And it is a tremendous tool to bring people to Jesus Christ. So Jesus is praying for those who will believe on our testimony. And then number 7. Jesus finally prays that the love of God that he has shown us would be in us. And that we would be where he is. This love that he has shared with us, and that love, of course, is demonstrated at the cross. That love that he has shared with us, that he asks us now to share with one another, love one another even as I have loved you. That love that he wants us to share with one another and everyone, he prays that that love will be in you, that you may be where he is. It's interesting that Jesus prayed in the 14th chapter. He said to his disciples there that he said, believe in God, believe also in me, for in my Father's house there are many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, then I will come back and take you so that where I am, you may be also. He prays this now at the end of the 17th chapter. He says this in verses 24 and 26. Father, I want those whom you have given me to be with me and where I am. He'd already asked that in 14. Now he already told them that in 14. He's praying it now in 17. And I want them to see my glory. Now glory, specifically in the context of the Bible, glory, real glory, belongs specifically to God. It belongs to God. He wants them to see his divine glory. His divine glory is completely revealed in heaven. It's not while he's there with them at the Last Supper. It's not going to be revealed there before everybody to see on the cross. This is a post-resurrection reality. And he wants them in heaven to see that. He wants you and me to see that in heaven. And he says in 26, I will continue, Jesus says, to make you known in order that the love that you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. This love is not a philosophical thing. This love is not a feeling. It's not simply an emotional thing. It's not merely an intellectual thing. It's not just a theological thing that we have come to learn, this love that God has for us. The love that God has for us is a love in which we're deeply, deeply connected to Jesus to the point that by His Holy Spirit He lives in us. We can bring the love of Jesus Christ into every circumstance of life, everywhere we live, because Jesus has chosen by His Spirit to have that love dwell in you and me. That love above everything else. To set yourself aside the way He did, to love as He loved. As I have loved you, Jesus said, love one another. Well, how did He love us? By giving Himself totally for us. That's the kind of transformational love that He is praying for you and me to have and to show to. Can you imagine how the world would change? How circumstances change, situations change when there is love. Richard Wurmbrand, who was responsible for establishing the Voice of the Martyrs organization, after World War II, after being in prison camp in World War II, after coming out of that, he became a Lutheran pastor in Romania, and he was put into prison for his faith because he wouldn't stop preaching, and he wouldn't stop sharing the gospel when the communist regime took over in Romania. And he was tortured. He was tortured on a regular basis. He was 7 years held in prison, mostly in solitary confinement, but when he would be tortured. So he would be hung up by his arm for hours, maybe even days, and he was whipped. All kinds of things happened to him. And one day his chief torturer came in, and he was praying. And the man that was torturing him said, your prayers aren't doing any good. Your wife is dead. Your child has been, your family's dead. They weren't. That was a lie. But he was told that. And he says, your prayers, who do you think you're praying for? And Wurmbrand looked up at the man and said, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. He prayed for his persecutor. That's exactly what Jesus said in Luke's Gospel. Pray for those who persecute you. And that's exactly what he was doing. He was showing his love for that man. That man, later on, was kicked out of the Communist Party. Was dying of cancer. That man had nowhere to go. He was a persona non grata in the whole USSR and all of its satellite countries. He couldn't go anywhere. He couldn't travel outside of Romania. He couldn't go anywhere. He had no friends. Nobody wanted to be associated with him because he'd been kicked out of the party. That man came and knocked on the door of Richard Wurmbrand's house and asked if he could stay there. And that man who was dying of cancer, who had been his torturer, and the torturer and responsible for the death of his wife's family, that man was taken into that house and shown the love of Jesus Christ until he died. That's love. That's the kind of love that Jesus is talking about here. There's glory in that love. That's the kind of love God had for you and me while we were still His enemies. God, Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. The sinless for the sinner. The righteous for the unrighteous. That's what He did for you. We are to love with that kind of incredible, dynamic love. And that's the prayer that He has for us in the 17th chapter. He prays that we have eternal life. He's still praying for us, interceding for us at the right hand of the Father. He prays for our protection in this world because we're still in this world. He prays that we would have the fullness of joy, His joy, the joy that comes from God. Jesus prays that we might be in the truth. We might know the truth and live by the truth of who He is and what He has done for us. And He prays for those who would come to believe because of our testimony. That you and I would give a testimony that is so strong in Christ that people would want to come to have that kind of love and joy in their heart. And finally, He prays that the very love of God that Jesus showed in His life would live in you and live in me, and that He would live in us. Amen? Amen. Let that peace of God, therefore, that passes our human understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, even to life everlasting. Amen. Let us now confess together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now we pause to hear the song, Be Thou My Vision.
Save that thou art.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Guard your people, O Lord, and grant us unity of faith and singleness of heart as we come to you in prayer. Lord, you have promised not to abandon your people, but to be with us always. Grant us grace to hear your word with faith and to live out what we hear and have received with holy lives before you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have delivered the saints from fiery trial and raised up the martyr from the darkness of death to everlasting life. Give us courage that we may give bold witness to the truth in our own day and proclaim Jesus Christ to the end of the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have pledged to us your Holy Spirit and promised to supply your church with apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers who will preach and teach your word. Give us ears to hear and hearts to believe your word. Raise up those who will serve your church in generations to come, that we may never be without the aid of those to serve us in the church in your holy name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have power over all things and appoint an order on earth for the protection of the weak, the punishment of evildoers, and the encouragement of virtue. Bless Donald Trump, our president, Brian Kemp, our governor, and all those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Give them wisdom for the challenges of our time and preserve them from any self-serving concerns. Give us grace that we may honor the gift of liberty and be good citizens and neighbors to all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have compassion upon all who suffer. Give grace and peace to the sick, to those with mental illness, to the dying, to their who are in their last hour, and to those who grieve. Hear us especially as we pray for Angela Murdahl recovering from aortic valve surgery and placement of a pacemaker. Give her peace, give her encouragement, relieve her of pain. Be with our sister Vicki Hecht, who is undergoing cancer treatments, also our brother Dan Zimmerman undergoing cancer treatments. Be with Margie Zacharias and her family on the death of her husband, Ravi Zacharias. For our pharmaceutical companies and that are here in the United States and all around the world, we're seeking the development of an effective vaccine for COVID-19. Father, we ask you that you would put your hand of mercy and peace upon this endeavor, that many people who are your people in faith would come to be able to be relieved of the burden of this plague. We pray for our frontline workers continually, for doctors and nurses and EMTs, for our policemen and our firefighters, our men and women who are in uniform, the truck drivers who have to continue to bring supplies around the world. We pray for our farmers and for our grocers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the unemployed, the underemployed, and the homeless. We pray that you would bless them. We pray that they would have the provision they need. We pray for the mission and ministry of Prince of Peace Lutheran Congregation, for the mission and ministry of Oak Road Lutheran Church and Congregation, and their new vicar, Andrew Rossman. We pray also for Bear Christian Hospital in Chirala, India. We pray for the Gospel Torch Ministry of Joseph Moses in Vijayawada, India. We pray for the mission to the unreached multitudes of Pastor Solomon in Hyderabad, India. We pray for the ministry and mission of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, which is in Mayalaguda, India. Father, we ask you to bless all of our partners around the world who are preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and meeting practical needs. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you are the source of all wisdom and knowledge. Bless those who teach, those who learn, and especially those who graduate this year. Be the hope of those whose plans have been disappointed, and grant that all graduates would find good employment. Guide them in the pursuit of your word and truth, to live honorable lives in worthy vocations, that in all things they may be glorifying you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have given us your own Son as our Savior and Redeemer. Guard the unity of this faith in the bond of love, that we would confess with one voice, Jesus, to be the risen and ascended Lord Christ, and to receive your blessing within this one faith. Hear our prayers for all for whom gathering together has been made difficult. Protect and keep us in the way of grace, and be merciful as we begin again gathering as one family in your presence in our church facility. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have daily and richly supplied us with all things that we need for body and life. Give us grateful hearts, that we may receive your gifts with thanksgiving, and bring to you our tithes, our gifts, our freewill offerings for the sake of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we rejoice in the Savior's promise to guard the people who wear your name by baptism and faith. Until we are with you in your presence forever, guard us against the evil one, who prowls like a roaring lion seeking whom he might devour. Grant us the power to resist him, steadfast in the faith, and to trust in you without fear. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Now we will join in singing A Mighty Fortress with the virtual choir of 176 people from 34 different countries. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.